Thank you. Brilliant. Well, it's nice to see you. It's nice to be here. Let me just check I'm on. Martin asked me about, was he a Christian at school? Well, I was brought up, my mum and dad were Christians, and we were a Christian family, we went to church and all of that. I actually grew up in a church, I don't know if you've come across them, called the Salvation Army. Does that mean anything to you? Yeah, Salvation Army, kind of like, they're a uniformed organisation, really. They have a uniform, they play, use bands and music and stuff. They do a lot of work with some of the poorest people in our country. But that was the church I grew up in. But when I was a teenager at school, I kind of wanted to keep two worlds separate. I don't know if you understand what I mean by this, but I kind of wanted to leave the church world. I wanted that world to be kind of one world, because I was very involved in the youth work and everything else. I wanted that to be one sort of side of my life. And I wanted school to be a different side of my life. And a big thing, the important thing I tried to make sure is that those worlds never met. Do you understand what I mean by that? So in the church, I was kind of like, I was the youth groups, I was played musical instruments, played my trumpet, played musical instruments, did all of that sort of stuff. And then at school, I was kind of just wanted to be like one of the lads. So I talked like them, and I acted like them, I just was one of the lads. I kind of was on the back row of most lessons, sort of fooling around, messing about, and just being sort of, this is an old-fashioned phrase called Jack the Lad. You may not know what that means, but I was kind of like just a buffoon, really. But that was really important. And the important thing was to try and keep these worlds apart, because this world with the church was very different than this world with the school. My life in school, my parents would have done their nut if they'd known what I was like in school. So keep them apart. And that worked really well. It was an absolute fail-safe way of living until I was 16. And then something happened. And what happened was, when I was 16, the BBC got in touch with the Salvation Army and asked whether they would be able to make a schools programme about two young people who belonged to that church, those churches. Well, my uncle was really quite high up in the Salvation Army. He's kind of like he was in charge. And so the posh word for this is nepotism. But he suggested that I might want to get this film. And I said yes, because the BBC said, if you make this film, we'll give you £10 and everlasting fame. It seemed too good a deal to turn down. So I said, 10 quid? 10 quid in 1970-something was quite a lot of money. So I said, yeah, I'll do it. Thinking that what they would do is film me in my Salvation Army life, the church life. No problem. It's a school's problem, no. So I did it. They came, they made this film of me and doing all my stuff. And I was chit-chatting about Jesus and church and all that sort of stuff and giving it all the patter. And then they went away. They went away for ages to make this film. Now, the next bit of this story, some of you will not quite believe. But the older folks will. There used to be a time in schools where the IT hadn't been invented at that point. All there was in schools was one television, all right? And it was about a 28-inch screen, all right, that was chained to a massive stand just in case anybody thought they might want to nick it. Nobody could have nicked it. It was that heavy that nobody would have wanted to steal it at all. But that was kind of like the technology. Some of you are nodding because, yeah, we remember that. And I was in the sixth form. And on a Friday afternoon, the lessons that sixth formers did was called general studies. I think it was kind of like a bit of everything, and it was a way for teachers just to get away from teaching kids on a Friday afternoon. So we'd often go down to the lecture hall, and we'd watch telly, films. So this Friday, they said, we're all going to go down Friday afternoon. All that. I'm on the back row, larking around. Some of you know where this story is going. I was on that back row, larking around, and the teacher at the front said, we've got something this afternoon that some of you might find really interesting. Well, it's me. It's me. There's 200 of my friends, and there's me on the telly talking about Jesus and talking about the church with my trumpet and my uniform doing an open air. I don't know what you think, how this world will end, but I was praying it would end really quick. It was like, do it now. I don't care whether I get sort of, I don't care where I go next, whether you leave me behind, whether you take me, whatever happens, just do something, God. And you know what God did? Nothing. And for the next 30 minutes, everybody watched me on telly while I'm sitting at the back row. Well, how would it have been for you? It's like, no. I went bright red. I thought, that's it. My social life is over. I am going to be a pariah. They're going to beat me up. I'm finished here. And anyway, as it finished, we all left the room. And as we were walking out of the room, one of my mates said, I can't use exactly the language he said, but he said, you don't believe all of that, do you? And it felt like time slowed down a bit. And I said, actually, I do. And I honestly think that's the moment I became a Christian. I think that's the moment I actually became a Christian. Because I'd taken everything that the church had sort of taught me, and I knew really well, and I'd come out in public and said, I think I do believe it. Now, that lad that asked me it, he was a really troubled guy. He was really troubled. He used to come to school drunk. In those days, you could do that. And he used to come to school drunk on a morning. It was really sad. But I didn't know any of, I knew that, but I didn't know that his mum was a Christian. And his mum had been praying for him like crazy since all his life, but particularly since he was 15. And he went to an outreach meeting. And he became a Christian not long after that event when he asked me the question. And God changed his life. And together, we did all sorts of things in the sixth form then. We set up Christian Union and we did all sorts of stuff. It was brilliant. Lots of people came to know Jesus during that time. But in a sense, I became a Christian because two worlds collided. And sometimes I wonder what would have happened to me if the BBC hadn't made that film. Because I think what would have happened is I'd have carried on living a school life and I'd have carried on living a church life. And I think I would have just kind of tried to keep two worlds separated. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Yeah? Does that sort of understand? And I think it was the grace of God for me that brought the two together. It was a bit of a shocking way to do it. It's like, if God wants to get your attention, he sometimes does it in ways that are really not socially appropriate. But it was God getting his attention, getting my attention, and that's how I became a Christian. Now, I pray that never happens to you. That you never have to have that clash in such a way. But I also pray, in a sense, that you understand what it means to live holy for Jesus without embarrassment. And what I want to talk to you about this morning, what I've been talking to the adults about earlier, the leadership of the church, is really about that. And we've got some slides to show you, so we'll work through the slides and we'll try and make sense. So what we've been doing is trying to make sense of church. And what I was doing earlier with the leaders was asking them, well, what did you learn about church during this sort of lockdown period? And I suppose what I'm wanting to ask you is, what have you learned about what it means to follow Jesus during this lockdown period where everything is sort of like out of kilter? Near this slide. When the Apostle Paul is writing, you know those letters, you know, from Romans all the way through the rest of the New Testament? What you've got is you've got the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as you know, and then the book of Acts, which is the story of the church being born. And then from there on, what you've got in the New Testament, rest of the New Testament, is a collection of individual letters that the Apostle Paul writes. And when he's writing to these early Christians, he's writing to them because they're trying to work out what it means to be a follower of Jesus in their context. So he writes one of the letters to the Corinthians. So the city was called Corinth. And Corinth was a really sophisticated city. It was a rich city. It was the place to be. It was where you'd go, where all the action is. And in Corinth, some people had heard about Jesus and become Christians there, but they still looked a bit like Corinth. In other words, they still had that sort of culture. So they were a bit more like Corinth than they were like Jesus. So, for example, one of the things was they were really competitive. So in Corinth was a city of competition. They had games, you know, like Olympic games, and everybody was really competitive. And that was really important. In Corinth, it was really important that you could be seen as wise, educated. That was really important. It was really important that you had leaders who were really strong. And so it was, all these people who become Christians, they kind of kept some of those things. And Paul writes letters to them to say, you need to be a little bit more like Jesus and a bit less like Corinth. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to ask you to try and find people around you to talk to. But if I was to ask you, now I'm not from here. In fact, I don't know this area at all. So when you talk about the area in which you live and at school, how do you talk about it? Is it just the Wirral? Is that what you, how do you talk about this area? The Wirral. Okay. Do Wirral people, does Wirral have a sort of a culture? Pardon? Okay. So just help me. What would those two cultures be? Yeah? Okay. So you got a well-off area and a less well-off area. Is he right? Yeah? Okay.
Sorry, put you on the spot like that. No, it's rubbish.
All right, it's a well-off area. And it, what area are you in? There's a voice from the back informing you which area you're in. See, I think it's nice around here, isn't it? Yeah? It's nice around here. Okay, so you know the kind of... So what do people in your area of the world, what do they think is really important in life? What does the good life look like for people who live in this sort of area? What's important? Okay. You may now have no idea, and you're going, I have no idea what he means. Go and look for someone who looks like they might have an idea and say, what's he mean? And I'll give you a chance to have a little conversation and then we'll feed it back. Is that all right? Yes? They're doing very well over here. All right, I'm glad they're here. All right. So, break out into little groups. What culture thinks really important? Thank you. what seemed to be important. Some of you just... Cars are important. But, okay, so we're going to need more information on this, because it's actually not about a car, is it, really? It's about something else. So what is it about the cars? A car is a sign of status. So what sort of car would people really like to drive?
A good one,
a good one, an expensive car. Okay. Now, they're going to use it to get to the same place as someone who's in a bit of a, you know, rust bucket. So a car is never really about a car, is it? It's about something else. So a car is a status symbol. Okay, brilliant. Something else about your culture, tell me. Yeah. Okay, so education is really important. You've got to work hard because if you work hard, you achieve. And if you achieve, you get a good car. Okay. We're finding the pathway. So actually, if you work hard at school, then you'll achieve and then you'll earn more. You'll be rich or you'll be able to get a status car, a car that gives you a status. Something else. Pardon?
A correct address.
Ooh. What's the correct address? Heswell. Where I live, I'm aware that I could step on really thin ice here, but where I live, we've got posh areas and then we've got not so posh areas. But some people who live in the not so posh areas, they then call themselves, they say they live in the posh area, and everybody else going, no, you don't. But do you know what I mean? You get that sort of, does that, so the address matters, where do you come from? So if you met someone who knew about the Wirral and you said, oh, I come from the Wirral, would they say, whereabouts?
Yeah.
And would that then be, oh,
yeah,
they're posh, or, they're on the other side of the track. Yeah, so the address matters, so the correct address matters. What else matters in here? What else were you saying?
With friends, social circle here.
Okay, so the friends you have. What sort of friends do you need? What are the right friends to have in Heswell? Are you going to answer that question? I'll come to you in a moment then. What are the right friends to have? Rich friends who've got posh cars. I can see what's been going on down here. Brilliant. What were you going to say? You can't remember. It was like 20 seconds ago. It's like, come on. Someone's trying to do hypnotism. Okay, if it comes back, put your hand up again and we'll come back to you. Yes. Loyal. People are loyal. So that's a good part of our culture, isn't it? People stick by people. Now it's come. People won't let you do dangerous things. What are you thinking of doing? Just interested. So people won't let you do dangerous stuff. So is that because they care and they're safe? People care for you. Yeah. Oh. Okay, so a sense of approval. Do people think I'm okay? Maybe that's something to do with friends as well, that sort of idea of...
positive and a negative thing?
Yeah, positive and negative thing. So you've got loyalty... you've got approval, you've got safety. Anything else that you were saying about your culture?
Yeah. People like to show that they're quite independent and that they don't really kind of need that extra support that you can kind of provide for them.
Okay, I don't know if you heard that back, but it's a good point. People like to see themselves as independent. We don't need support. We don't need other people. We can manage on our own. We certainly don't need a crutch of religion. Right at the back. Is that right? Well, I can understand why. It's nice. Yeah. So it's a homecoming place. Anything else? So, like in any culture, there's some good things that you say, yeah, they're fantastic. Loyalty, fantastic. Friends who stick by you, fantastic. There's some things that, actually, we look out for each other's safety. That's fantastic. That sense of actually it's home, fantastic. And then there's other things you go, not so sure about. Well, when Paul is writing the letters into the New Testament, he's writing to people, and what he's wanting to say is, be careful that you don't look more like your culture than you do Jesus. That's what he's trying to do all the time. In one of the letters in Corinthians, he says, we're living through a particular moment, and in the particular moment, there's a present crisis, and the crisis is probably a famine. And he's saying, actually, in this crisis, think through what it means to follow Jesus. Think through what it means to be a follower of his. Can you take me to the next slide, please? This is a sort of a representation of what it feels like to be a Christian in the UK at the moment. There's 100 dots in the diagram, and there's 6 red dots. Now, this is a rough number. But the 6 red dots represent 6%, so 6 out of every 100 people in the UK as a whole, who go to church to worship once a month or more. So the red dots represent the percentage of people in our population who worship in church once a month or more. People like you. So you are in the 6%. All right? Now, the other 94%... don't think, they're not against the church. They're not negative about it. They just don't think it's for them. It's like, I just don't do church. So let me ask you a question. When you see that diagram, how does it make you feel? Yeah. Special. Special. Yeah. How else does it make you feel? Marginal. Sort of like pushed to the side, small. What else might it make you feel? Yeah. Sad. Sad that it's not more. What else might it make you feel?
Different.
What else? Anything else? There's a lot more to do. If we're going to reach people with the good news, there's a lot to do. Now, when you're in church together, in your groups or your service or you're with your friends here in church, and you pray together and you worship together and you listen to the sermons together, what's the culture of the church? What matters in church? You've done what matters in Heswell, but what's important in church? Do you want to just have a think with those people you were talking with a moment ago? What's important about the culture of the church? So what do you do? And what does that say about your culture? What do you celebrate? What does that say about your culture? How do you operate? What does that say about your culture? All the same sort of things, but about church life. Can you do that for a moment? Or at least look at each other blankly for a few minutes, and then I'll call you back. Thank you. 10%. What do you do with that matters? Yeah. You treat each other as family. What else do you do? Yes. E-kids. Tell me about e-kids. The kids work. And what do you do in e-kids? What do you actually do when you get together? Play games, learn about the Bible, do crafts, sing songs. What sort of songs do you sing? Tell me about the songs you sing. My Lighthouse. Everybody loves My Lighthouse. Yeah. Talk about the Bible. Okay. So all of those things in E-Kids. Do you know why it's called E-Kids? Why is it called E-Kids?
No idea.
It's a mystery. It's a mystery. It's a mystery. Does that come hard? Is that like a wound? We're going to have a time of prayer later and pray. So you tell stories, you read the Bible, you sing songs like My Lighthouse, and you treat each other, what did you say? Treat each other like family. What else do you say about your culture in the church?
We have a lot of support.
You have a lot of support? You were going to say that. How do you do that thing? You get a lot of support. What else were you going to say? You're a community together that's known, that you hang together. No one feels left out. That's the desire, that no one would feel left out. What about at the back there, the cheap seats? So there's a lot of encouragement, a lot of sharing. People pray for you. In other words, I'm taking a long time to say something very simple. Can you see that your culture of the church is different in some ways than the culture of Heswell? In your church, does it matter what car you drive? Do people look down on you if you don't have a posh car? You would really hope not. If you're having a hard time, do people want to help you? Or does everybody think we can manage on our own? No. You want to support each other. And when you sing My Lighthouse, let's talk about My Lighthouse. My Lighthouse, My Lighthouse. Come on. Shining in the darkness.
I will follow you.
I will follow you. Whoa, whoa. They just ran out of words at that bit. Whoa, whoa. You're doing really well. That sounds brilliant. That sounds brilliant. My Lighthouse, My Lighthouse. We will follow you. Safe to shore. All of this to say this. What you're doing as a community of young people subverts, it rebels against, it overturns the culture that you're surrounded by. So your culture says, stand on your own two feet. What you're learning in church is, you can't, you need each other. Your culture says, you can live life according without God. Church goes, you're daft if you try. Your culture says, get educated, because if you get educated, you'll get a good job, you'll get a decent car, etc. And in church, what are you saying in church? Education matters, but why does it matter? Because it's a way of helping. Why else does it matter? Because there's something that God has created you to be, and it's important that it blossoms, that you become the person God wants you to be. Any other reasons why education matters? Yeah, you can offer it to God. It's kind of like, this is my life. I'm giving it to you, God, and as part of my life, doing homework matters. But it's not about money. You may do really well educationally and get a degree and then another degree and then another degree. In fact, if you don't want to work for quite a while, do that. Do A-levels and then go to college and get an undergraduate degree and stay on and get a master's degree. And then if you really don't want to work, carry on and get a PhD. You can put off work till you're about 30 at the very least. But it's not about money. It's about, well, how can I offer what I do for the sake of others? We were chatting before about homeschooling and the experience of homeschooling with William and Matthew and William. And together they were saying to me, they discovered during lockdown and homeschooling that they need teachers. What a discovery. I mean, to be fair to them, it took 4 months, but they discovered at the end of 4 months that actually you can't really manage without teachers. And what are teachers doing? They're investing in you and bringing something out of you. Now, all of that to say is, can you see how significant it is to belong to church? Because two things. One, you're in a minority. When my children are adults now, but when my children were at school, in their school, 900 pupils, just down the road from where we lived, 900 pupils, and there were probably about 6 people in their school that went to church once a month. And my kids weren't friends with any of them. They were really a small minority. You're in the minority. But the significance, and I want to come back to your first answer. What's your name? Dion? Sion? Fion. I would have got there eventually. Fion. Sorry, Fion. It's not easy with the mask, is it? And my hearing's going. Fion. Fion said when she saw this picture first, her first comment was, it makes you feel special. And actually, that's not a bad way of looking at it. You're different, but it's a good different. And it's important that as you do the stuff you do with your groups and your church, that actually you stay different. Resist the culture. When your mates say, "Cool, look at the car you drive," laugh. Laugh. The thing the culture can't stand is if you laugh. They say, "No, don't be daft. Don't get sucked in." Because, next slide, please. Can you see this one? When you scatter, when you're not in church together, this is where you are, scattered around. Now, how does that make you feel? When you look at that, when you scatter, you're in schools, you're in different classes, different year groups, you're in different parts of the world. When you see that picture, how does that picture make you feel? Fionn's gonna be first again. Go on, Fionn. What? Lonely. Yeah, it makes you feel lonely. What else does it make you feel when you see this picture? Radical. Very different. What else did it make you feel? Separated. Yeah? Hopeful. Uneasy. Good word. What else? Strategic. Now, both of those positive words and negative words are both true. How many of you find it difficult if you feel like you're the only church-going Christian in your circle of friends? How many find that quite difficult? Yeah. Some of you do. Because it kind of feels like you stand out a bit, doesn't it? It might feel that sometimes you go, I can't do that. Or I've got to be different. And it can feel quite awkward at times. And it can feel uneasy, to use your word. It can make you feel uneasy. But on the other hand, you use the word strategic. What if God's placed you with that circle of friends? What if God wants you to be in that circle of friends because you're different? Because you know Jesus, because actually you're following him. Maybe this is what God's asked of you. It only works if two things are true, though. When you scatter like this, if, number one, you stay red. If you go grey and look like everybody else, then God can't use you. And secondly, you've got to say, this is, at the moment, my space. This is where I belong. This is where God's placed me. Now, here's the truth. And I want to say to you that are under the age of 16 something that those of us over the age of 16 know to be true. Those of us over the age of 16 most of the time don't feel massively confident. Most of us over the age of 16 are often in places where we think, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing, or I don't know how I'm supposed to be doing this. I don't feel massively confident. And it's easy for those of you under the age of 16 to look at adults and go, they've got it all sorted out. They must be over age. It's not. We feel the same. And it's one of the reasons we need each other. It's one of the reasons we pray with each other. It's one of the reasons we encourage each other. Somebody said that earlier. It's because actually we want to stay red when sometimes we don't feel very confident. Does that make sense? Okay. I've got one more thing I want to say, and then we'll perhaps pray for one another. And we're going to flick through some slides that I'm not going to talk about. You'll be very glad to know. This is all the stuff you've missed. Carry on. Yeah, carry on. Yes. Back. I'm getting carried away at the back. It's like, yeah, stop. Can you take away my picture there? That's great. When you are in the places you're in, one of the really good ways of thinking, well, what's God wanting to do here? Is to ask these sorts of questions. On the right-hand side of that screen, you see those four words, creation, fall, redemption, restoration. So that is the big story of the Bible, all right, from Genesis through to Revelation. The big story of the Bible is, and by the way, it's really interesting, that when the Bible was given to us, it wasn't given like an encyclopedia to work out what to do when. You know, I'm being bullied. What does the Bible say? Let's look under B for bullying. Bible doesn't work like that. What it does, it tells you the story of what God's doing in the world. And the story is, it begins with creation. There is a fall. Things go drastically wrong. And that's why, by the way, when you see what the world is like, some days you think, it is beautiful. It's a beautiful, beautiful world. And then other days you look and you go, oh, it's a mess. And the reason is because the story goes, God created it beautiful. And humanity said, we can manage without God. And they mucked it up. That's why you see the best of the world and the worst of the world. But then, as the story develops, Jesus comes. And in the life of Jesus, in the cross and in the resurrection, there is redemption. Things are bought back. We're going to make this different. And God, when he sent Jesus, he didn't send Jesus to do two things. One, he didn't send Jesus so that you might believe in him just so you can go to heaven. And secondly, he didn't send Jesus that you might believe in him just so you can go to church. He sent Jesus who died for you that you might say, yes, he's my Lord, I'm going to follow him, because God's got a plan for the whole world and he includes you. That's why Jesus came. And one day, everything will be restored. But we live between redemption and restoration. We live between Jesus and when everything is restored, when God finally says, I'm coming to sort everything out. And in the meantime, we who are Jesus' followers go, I know what God wants to do around here, and I'm going to try and bring that into the present. And a way of working that out is, what's God's desire for your world? So not the world as big, because that's too big for us to think about. But think about your school or your college. What's God's desire for your school or your college? And what's broken there? And what can you do to change it? I'm going to ask you to go back into your groups. This is the last thing we'll do. I want you to go back into your groups for a minute. And I want you to think about your school and ask those three questions. Now, I suspect that in some of your groups, some of you let some of the adults talk more than you talk. But this is only you can do this talk now. So, what's God's desire for your school? What does God want for your school? What's broken there? In other words, what's not working right? And what can you do to change that? Does that make sense? It's the last time you'll have to break out. So break out. I'll give you 5 minutes, and then we'll come back, and we'll see where we're up to. What did some of you say? What's God's desire for your school or your, in some cases, your club, because they're a different context. But what's your desire? What's God's desire for your school? What did you say? The people are happy that they feel. Let's explore that a bit more. What does happiness look like in a school context?
Well, people are
Yeah. Let me just pause so they can hear. So we said God's purpose is for it to be a happy place. But really, when we drill down, that looks like people feel happy. They feel like they've got a space there. They belong. That they're connected with people. That they're fulfilled. Yeah. Anybody else? What did you say about your school? Yeah, Fionn. Sorry, I may have missed the first part of this. Is this God's desire for school, or is this what's broken? Yeah, I think. Let's come to brokenness in a minute. What's God's desire? But hold that thought, Fionn, because we know that thoughts go quite quickly out of your head. So hold that thought. Don't lose that thought, Fionn, because it's a good thought. Right? What's God's desire for your school? Somebody else. What did you say? You got anything, lads? Okay, so that God actually wants to get the attention of people in school. That God loves these young people and actually wants to get their attention. And maybe there's ways of doing that. What did some of you say? Do you have anything? What's God's desire for your school? Okay, we'll come to the other stuff. How about you? Have you got anything for God's desire for your school? Any of you at the back there? Okay, so the clubs that allow people to connect and belong. So what we're saying is something very similar. I think we're saying it across at the moment. I'm sure there's other things going through your head, but there's essentially what we want is these schools to thrive. We want schools to be communities where people feel valued, able to do their best, and all the other sort of stuff. That's what we want. And I think you're right. I think that is God's desire. God's heart is for people. God's heart is that actually this world might reflect something of the createdness of God. And in school, that's very much what it involves. I think there's a lot of other things, but it includes that for sure. What's broken, Fionn? This is your moment, don't blow it. We knew this would happen. Come on, Fionn. It's about being judged. Yeah. Okay, so if you do something wrong, people judge you. What else is broken in your school? Yeah. Let me come down and... Respect is broken. What else did you say is broken? You said you had some other stuff, didn't you?
Like people kind of don't include other people, and they kind of what I'm saying down there about, like, if you do something wrong, or if you're different, you might not get included.
Yeah, people don't easily include people, and particularly if you're different, you can feel excluded. Anything else? Okay, so they get angry, they hate each other sometimes about petty things. So it's a breakdown in relationships. Now here's the thing. You have no authority in school, do you? You're not running the school? Any head teachers here amongst the people that have just spoken? No? No teachers? No? No? You're not in charge. You're not in charge. But you are there. You're the red dot in a sea of grey. Do you remember that picture of the scattered red dots? So what can you do to change the brokenness?
Be kind.
You can be kind. What else?
Help each other.
You can help each other. You can include people. It's annoying when that happens, isn't it? What can you do to change? You talked about respect. What can you do to change some of that brokenness? It's really easy to judge people and to choose not to. Really hard, but actually, I can choose not to do that. In other words, I can become an example of what God would want it to look like around here. That's not being goody two-shoes. That's not being smarmy. That's not being teacher's pet. That's actually saying there's a better way to live. And the better way to live is modeled with all those things you said about church earlier. Do you remember when we talked about the difference of the culture of church? And what you're doing is you're then taking some of the best of the culture of church and you're saying, actually, we could do that. I could do that here. You may look different, but the truth is you are. You are different. Because you pray and you worship and you sing My Lighthouse. And it tells a different story about the world. And it's not easy. But it matters enormously. And what we're going to do, because it matters so much, is I'm going to ask all the adults to stand for a moment. Just the adults to stand. And I'm going to ask them to, if they need to sort of turn around so they can see some of the folks who are sitting. Because these adults are going to pray for you because they know you've got a tough gig. They know this isn't easy, but they know it really matters. And we believe that God will use you. That you become an agent of change. That you are the red dots. And sometimes that's not easy. But we're going to pray that God would keep you as a red dot in those contexts. Is that okay? So if you're sitting down, you don't need to do anything really at this point. This is brilliant. Because these adults are going to do it for you. They're going to pray over you. And they're going to ask those adults, if you can, pray specifically. You know these young people. Some of them are your own, but you know them by name. Will you pray for them by name now, out loud, so they can hear you pray for them as you commission them back into their context? Will you do that? Off you go. Pray for each young person by name. I want everybody's name to be used. Let's do it. for you that are sitting, that you'll help to keep a culture of a church so that actually it values the good things about one another and stays connected to God. I pray that you will do that. And so together you'll be red dots gathered. And when you scatter, I pray for you that are sitting, that you will know what God wants you to do in your way, with your personality, at your stage. And you'll do it with courage, even if sometimes you feel a bit frightened. I pray that when you're in school or in your groups with your friends, that you will know how to be wise and what to say at the right time. And I pray you won't mind if people think you're odd. I pray you that are seated would see things change, and I pray that you'll see your friends come to know Jesus. I pray that you that are seated will learn what it means to minister to other people, and you will rise up to be the next generation. We pray blessing on you that are seated. And we send you in the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus which will keep you safe, the name of Jesus which will mean that you're in his hands and that he's there for you. We ask this in the name of our Father together, who hears our prayers and answers them, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. Been lovely to meet you. Thank you for engaging. Been great. I hope you found it helpful. Thank you very much.